Myself, Smita Nautiyal, your host for today's panel discussion on the role of forestry in implementing international agreements in Commonwealth members and beyond, moving from agreed texts to action on ground. On this platform today, we all have an opportunity to listen and enlighten ourselves through discourses by luminaries of forestry. May I now request Dr. Hosni L. Lakhani to be the moderator for today's session. Dr. Hosni L. Lakhani, sir, please be on dais with us. Dr. Hosni L. Lakhani is adjunct professor and director of international programs, University of British Columbia. In 1995, Dr. Lakhani joined FAO as Assistant Director de Cabinet, and in 1998 was appointed as Assistant Director General of FAO in charge of the Forestry Department until his retirement 2005. Dr. Lakhani was member of several scientific and professional bodies, including Board of Trustees of CFOR and ICRAF. Thank you, sir, for being with us. May I now invite upon our esteemed panelists to grace the dais. I call upon Dr. John Innes, Professor and Dean, Faculty of Forestry, UBC, to honor the chair. Thank you, sir. Dr. S. C. Gorilla, Director General, Indian Council of Forestry Research and Education and Chancellor for FRI Deemed University. Sir, I request you to grace the dais. Thank you, sir. I also call upon Dr. Peter Holmgren, Director General, CFOR Indonesia, to be here with us on dais. Dr. Ben Chikamai, Director Chief Executive Officer, Kenya Forestry Research Institute. Sir, kindly grace the dais. Thank you, sir. Dr. Rob D. Fegley, Director and National President of the Institute of Foresters of Australia, is here with us. Sir, kindly be here with us on dais. Now I request Dr. Savita, Director FRI and Vice Chancellor FRI Deemed University, to join us on dais. I also request Dr. Merlin V. Headley, CEO and Conservator of Forest Jamaica, to be here with us on dais. Thank you, ma'am. I also request Dr. Harry Studholm, Chairman, Forestry Commission, Eglin, to grace the chair on dais. Thank you so much, sir. Now, I hand over the stage to Dr. Lakhani. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning, everybody. This is really a great honor to moderate this very high-level panel. You heard the subject of this panel, which is the role of forestry in implementing international agreements in the Commonwealth member countries and beyond, moving from text to action on the ground. As you probably know, the forests and forestry have been raised to unprecedented heights on the international development and climate agendas. There are three major agreements affecting forestry. The first one is the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, adopted by the UN Sustainable Development Summit in September 2015, and subsequently endorsed by the UN General Assembly. There are 17 SDGs, or Sustainable Development Goals. Number 15 reads, protect, restore, and promote sustainable use of terrestrial ecosystems, sustainably manage the forest, combat desertification, and halt and reverse land degradation and halt biodiversity loss. In addition, it says, halt deforestation, restore degraded forests, and substantially increase afforestation and reforestation globally. The second agreement, international agreement, is the Paris Agreement. It's one of the outcomes of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change in 2015. And forests are really particularly featured on the Paris Agreement, especially red, which is the reduced deforestation and degradation. It's a key climate mitigation tool. Article 5 reads, parties should take action to conserve and enhance sinks and reservoirs of greenhouse gases, including forests, and request countries to implement and support, including, and this is very important, through result-based payments. The existing framework incentives for activities related to REDD+ for the integral and sustainable management of forests while reaffirming the importance of intensifying non-forest benefits. The third one is the International Arrangement on Forests and the UN Strategic Plan for Forests 2017 to 2030. And this was established by the UN and they will be endorsed in next May by the United Nations General Assembly. So, this panel, our intention is to shed some light on the implementation. These are texts approved and by the representatives in the UN, in New York, or wherever, and it comes to the country as an agreement endorsed by the respective parliament. So this is a binding agreement, which means that two things. This agreement is negotiated by the diplomats, approved by the parliament, but it comes to foresters to implement. And most of the cases I've seen around that the foresters who are responsible for implementation are not involved in the negotiation. It just comes at the text, do this. That's one thing. Second issue is that there is a lot of money associated with this. You can apply for money for implementing, and there is a lot of mechanism around the world with a lot of money for implementation. So we want to know what to do with the implementation. So we're honored to have the panel with us, and I will call on the panel to please speak. We will go from left, right, and then left, and we keep alternating. But please confine your presentation to maximum of 7 minutes, because we were asked to try to finish by 15 minutes to 11, because there is another event. We have a young lady here with a sign of 2 minutes, and if not, there will be a red sign to please stop. We'll try to run this as a very active panel, and after that, there will be a few minutes for questions and answers. And then I will ask each panelist to give me 2 messages based on his or her presentation to be part of the final recommendations or the communique from this conference. So please, while you're discussing this, just write down 2 points, not more than 1 line each, please. It's much more difficult to write 1 line than a whole page, I know. So think about it this while we are sitting here and give it to me. Okay. Now we will start with Ms. Marilyn Headley. She is the conservator of forests in Jamaica. Marilyn, please. And you have the chair, either you talk from the podium or while for sitting there. Please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Good morning, everybody. So we are bright and early. I'm Marilyn Headley, and I'm appointed CEO and Conservator of Forests and the Forest Department in Jamaica. I'm going to walk you through this morning very quickly the process we went through for our national plan. We had a national plan before which we got approved in 2001, and we decided that this was time now to have a new one because so many things have changed since then. We've kind of wrapped 3 different plans with 3 different agreements in one. So it was our National Action Plan for the UNFF. It's also the Forest Sector Plan, as our legislation requires, and it is also the Climate Resilience Plan for the forest sector in Jamaica under the UNFCC. The process for the plan, we started like very late 2014 with a preliminary investigation. We did the gap analysis of the plan that we had before. And then we moved on to the fact that we started to get additional consultants. We utilized, we got funding from USAID under a climate change project, and that brought in the United States Forest Service team members who worked along with us. The plan is supported by the Forest Act. It is also aligned to the forest policy, which was just recently approved in 2016. And we are also aligned to the climate change framework in Jamaica. It is attached also and aligned to a national plan in Jamaica, which we call Vision 2030, and the Protected Area Systems Master Plan. International obligations include, we looked at the SDGs, the related ones, UNFF, the Forest Instrument, the UNFFCC, the UNCBD, the Ramsar Convention, and UNESCO World Heritage Sites. All of these were brought in together as we developed our plan. The four global objectives under the FI were the key areas that we centered our plan around, because it looked at the whole thing about reversing forest loss, and that was critical to us. Our plan looking at building climate resilience also addressed the fact that globally, countries agree that forests are the key climate solution, and we are committed to providing strong collective and urgent action to promote equitable rural economic development, reversing deforestation, and massively increasing forest restoration. So that was our aim in our plan. In Jamaica, we had just completed our forest resource assessment. So we did our land use assessment, completed that in 2015. So that fed into our plan, giving us information on what types of forest cover we have, how much forest cover, which one we're losing, and which one is increasing. So that was critical into how we're going to develop the plan. We identified that we gained a lot of secondary forests, but we lost our natural forests, our closed broadleaf, and our swamp forests. Our swamp forest is almost down to zero. But we decided that those are the areas that we're going to focus on. We identified a goal, and we also had six strategic objectives. We looked at protection, adaptation, mitigation, sustainable forest management, sustained forest sector, and mitigation for utilization, and also to look at building capacity for the forest to protect, conserve, and manage our forest estate. Our process was very interactive. We had a number of government entities working very closely with us in a committee, and then we had stakeholders who we took our plan to in initial stages to get an idea of what one wants to include in the plan. So that was our preliminary. Having looked at all of that, the then process now was to decide what it is we're going to be keeping in the plan. So we ended up with four pillars. We looked at protection, adaptation, mitigation, sustainable forest management as one, and then sustaining the forest sector. On the protection, the idea was now to enhance our legal and enforcement activities. And with our forest policy just being approved, and now we're looking to amend the Forest Act. So with the Forest Act, at the same time, the plan says this is what we are going to be doing. So our legal and enforcement activities are going to be improved, and that's a key one with the protection. Collaboration with the other entities, because Jamaica is a small place, so we have a number of entities working together under the same, under different umbrellas. So the persons working with protected areas, with wildlife and heritage, we're all working together to protect the forest estate. On the adaptation, the key one was our swamp forest and mangrove forest. We felt that we had to really ensure that we protected the swamp and mangrove forest. On the sustainable forest management, utilization, the communities, the groups who are dependent on our forest, how we're going to be working with them. And then in addition to that, the conservation of the forest that we want to ensure that we cannot lose anymore. Red Plus is another key factor, and forest research. Because with our Red Plus, we are just starting that process, and we're now going to be looking at our red strategies and how we're going to get into being red ready. With our research, we're looking at mangroves and swamp forests. the impact of climate change on forest types and non-timber forest products. We had a number of cross-cutting entities like public education and awareness and training and capacity building. Those cut across all the activities that we had, all the pillars, so they are cross-cutting. And then there was a whole discussion about financing. We looked at and are still looking at sources such as the GCF out of the Paris Agreement. We're now starting a project with UN Environment to really look at how we can start our RED program. So with that, we're looking to the GCF. We've always been working with the GEF, and that will continue. And then after we finished the draft, we then went back to the stakeholders across the island. We had a number of meetings. We got inputs from them. And then we are now putting together those inputs in collaboration, and then hand it over to the ministry and the minister for approval from the parliament. And then that will be our 10-year plan for the forestry sector. So everybody's involved with it, and everybody will be involved in the implementation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madam. Thank you also for keeping the time. Now, our next speaker is Dr. John Ennis. He's a professor and dean of Faculty of Forestry, UBC Canada. John, you have the floor, please.
So thank you for this opportunity to talk about the role that I believe that education and research has in promoting the role of forests in international agreements and the implementation of those agreements. From my perspective, I had to think about what is my perspective a little bit. Is it as the Dean of Forestry at a university forestry school, or is it related to my role in the Commonwealth Forestry Association? And I'm sort of going to mix those a little bit. In terms of research and education, essentially scientists go where the money is. And that money, with the exception of the EU, is generally at a national level. We've heard that there is a lot of money available through the Global Environment Facility and green climate funds, but very little, if any, of that money is actually reaching the educational establishments, such as universities. We hear a lot about capacity building, and we believe that universities have a role to play in that, but as I said, that money is not flowing down to the university level. We know that national governments are interested in research, and they will promote research generally within their national interests. There are a few exceptions: USA, Australia, Germany, Sweden, France, Finland. I don't include Canada in that list. Very few other countries seemingly are willing to put a lot of money into research internationally. On the education side, the Commonwealth really has no system of coordination of forestry education. Now, if you have a sense of deja vu with that statement, it was because it was made by someone called R.S. Troop back in 1920, at the very first of these conferences. Now we're saying it again. What happened then was that they recommended that Oxford take on that role, but as I'm sure you all know, the Oxford Forestry Institute is no longer with us, and there is actually no forestry education now at Oxford, and no one else has been able to step into that gap. The FAO has talked about education, but it is largely ineffective, and it was actually taken out of their mandate at one stage, although it has now crept back in a very minor way. APEC has a strong role in this area, and that role is actually growing, primarily through the Chinese-funded Asia-Pacific Forestry Network. They have established a database of education programs. There are regular coordination mechanisms, and they are developing online courses in forest management, which potentially offer a way forward. But that is a mixture of Commonwealth countries and other countries. And within IUFRO, there has been some activity, although it is mainly research-focused. In terms of policy development, where could education and research help? I believe that the universities and other educational institutions could and should have a role, but they are largely excluded in many countries. It's quite interesting, when I was in Switzerland before I moved to Canada, I was actually a lead author of the IPCC, which you could say is a policy-oriented organization using science as the basis. When I moved to Canada, I was no longer part of that. The Canadians didn't feel that that expertise was warranted, although IUFRU subsequently brought me in. So IUFRU is doing quite a lot in this area and is helping push research forward, but it is not working in the education area. In terms of how research and education could contribute to forest management, we have a huge potential role through research forests and the bilateral work that goes on between researchers across different universities. There are potential links to professionalism and professional development, but we need to work out how we reward university employees who do that. At the governance and institutional issues, in many countries we see researchers, university workers in the education sector being actively excluded, which is actually a fairly serious problem. I do believe, however, that we have a mechanism within the Commonwealth that could contribute enormously within this area, and that is the Standing Committee on Commonwealth Forestry, which you heard about a little bit yesterday. Unfortunately, we find that Commonwealth countries generally are showing very little enthusiasm for this mechanism. In fact, the attendance at the meetings is generally very, very poor, ranging from only 3 or 4 countries to a maximum, actually, at the most recent meeting of about 12 countries. So I believe we need to urge countries to make use of this mechanism to move forward within this area of governance and institutional contributions. Finally, along intersectoral collaboration, the lines really are blurred in the academic realm. They are much more blurred than inside government. We find that researchers and educators often work together to try and solve particular problems and are increasingly doing so. And I'm sure we'll hear more from Peter Holmgren about his researchers at C4, the way they achieve that. The danger, however, is that we lose some very specialized forestry knowledge. And I'm thinking in particular of silvicultural knowledge. If we all become environmental scientists, how will we know how to grow trees? I will stop on that point.
Thank you very much, John. Now, our third speaker this morning is Mr. Rob DeFigli, who is the chairman of the Forestry Tasmania and director of Margulis Groom Consulting Firm in Melbourne, Australia. Rob, you have the floor, please.
Thank you very much, Hosni, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I just want to talk a little bit to you this morning about getting action on the ground and how we actually make a difference to the forests that we love dearly and enjoy working with and seeing the results of our efforts. I was reflecting a little bit about what to say this morning, and I thought back on my career. Last month I celebrated 37 years in the Australian forest industry. And the very first conference I went to was in 1983, run by the Institute of Foresters, of which I'm now proud to be their national president. But it was a conference in Melbourne themed around facing forestry's future. And this is 34 years ago. And the guest speaker, the keynote speaker, was a person who was mentioned yesterday, was the late, great Jack Westerby. I was enthralled listening to this guy with this broad North Yorkshire accent. He had a great sense of humour. And a very, very keen insight and understanding of how the world worked and what happened. And he made this comment about he loved coming to Australia and he loved talking to people, and he thought he was very well hosted and everybody looked after him and he had a wonderful time and dinners were good. And he said, "You've all been very polite and listened to all the things I've had to say, and then you've studiously ignored everything I said." I think, unfortunately, the Indian expert that came to Australia in the early 1900s to suggest Australia how we might manage our forests got the same treatment. We're not particularly good at taking advice from people overseas, and that's a fault in the way in which we operate, but it's a culture that we have and something in some cases we're very proud of. But Jack made a comment at that conference, and he said, will forestry survive? He said, forestry will survive, there's no problem about that, but I have a concern about whether foresters will survive. He said, the problem is that the rise of the anti-timber industry groups, the conservationists, and we're talking about the early 1980s, was a real concern to foresters. Foresters were saying to Jack that they were the real conservationists. We are the professionals, we're trained, we know what we're doing. How can these people come up, turn it up off the street with just an idea and a bit of emotion and a powerful lot of presence, take the arguments away from us? And Jack's argument was to suggest, I think you're suffering from Daddy Knows Best. You've spent far too much time thinking that you are the only experts in the forest, and you're not actually talking to people enough about what's going on and telling them why you're doing certain things. And we spent a little bit too much time working for our masters rather than working for our communities. And again, Jack was very critical of this. He said that you cannot serve two masters. There is only one master, and that is your community, and forests, as he said, are about people. And then you're working for people and obviously the community and the forest in turn. I think it's really interesting that the whole thrust of what he was doing is that we were paying way too much attention to our political masters in that case, not enough attention to the community. You know, in sort of understanding things and sort of thinking a little about where I've come from since then, we still suffer from that problem. And we still suffer in many ways from not really understanding how to come together and work together. You know, we all like to be individuals, we've got different issues, but a lot of them are the same. I went to a COP meeting in Bali a number of years ago, and I was astounded and amazed at this whole movement of people, everyone running around with worried looks on their faces, the world was about to end. It didn't, but, you know, it could have. But it was just an interesting experience. But I went away from there thinking, what did I learn? And it wasn't very much. As a practicing forester, there was nothing there for me to advise my clients about what we should do in managing forests. John just talked a little bit about education. Education in Australia is declining. There were two very strong forestry institutions running in Australia when I was a young graduate. Now we're really struggling. We've got one and we've got a master's program and we're still struggling to get students. We are not working well. Foresters were trained well to be professionals but not communicators. And we weren't good at communicating, particularly the people that were important, which is the public. If you communicate well with the public and the community and you get the community on side, then politicians fall in behind you because they're too frightened to do anything else. You become untouchable. But unfortunately, we've worked the other way and we have to go back to that community. We need to develop some connections though. And my final point is this, how do we get connected? To me, that's really about, as a national president, I became president in 2012, and I do not know whether there is a professional forestry association here in India. And I've looked and I've tried to find them. We have a very close relationship with the New Zealand Institute of Forestry. We've developed one with the Chinese Society of Forestry. I work well with John and with Geraint Richards and His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales to develop an award for our young foresters through the UK system. But there are more foresters out there that should be connected and should be talking, and we should be looking at ways in which we can help one another. So I think in summary, Hosni, we need to listen better. We haven't been good at doing that. The important thing though is knowing what to listen to. There's lots of things to listen to out there and there's lots of things to read. But what is the real importance? The things that are going to make a difference to us. And how do we connect and exchange ideas? How do we as professional foresters come together and learn from one another and take away things that are going to be useful for us? We don't have that forum. And finally, communication. We have to learn to be great communicators, and we have to be able to do that so that we communicate to our communities. So, in my view, Hosni, we need a professional forum for foresters working on the ground to exchange ideas and experiences, and that, I believe, will make a difference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Rob, especially for those set of recommendations. Now, I move to Dr. Savita, the Director of Forest Research Institute of India. Dr. Savita, please.
Thank you, Dr. Lakhani. Fellow panelists sitting on the dais, learned participants attending this conclave, Good morning. Namaskar. It is my honor to participate in the Commonwealth Forestry Conclave today as one of the panelists. I take this opportunity to thank the conference organizers for inviting me on the panel and share my views. I would like to begin my talk with one verse, that is shloka, from one of the Vedic epics of Indian history, that is called Yajur Veda. And the para number is 36.17. It says, "Unto heaven be peace, unto the sky and earth be peace. Peace be unto the water, unto the herbs and trees be peace." This very Sanskrit shloka, or verse for that matter, emphasizes our rich heritage and traditions. India has a long history and tradition of harmonious coexistence between man and nature. Human beings have been regarded fauna and flora as part of their family. This is part of our heritage and manifest in our lifestyle and our traditional practices as well. Indian culture and traditional practices aimed at balancing contentment and worldly desires that helps pursue a path of sustainable lifestyle. It is our moral responsibility to ensure that we leave the future generation a healthy and beautiful planet. We all are aware that world countries took bold actions and launched new initiatives in compliance of priority recommendations and decisions taken by different global forums and international agreements with regard to three conventions emerged from Rio Summit, Paris Agreement, and most recent UN initiative on 2030 agenda. India is no exception. The Government of India, the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, various state governments, international donor and conservation agencies, non-government organizations, civil societies, and local communities have launched several countrywide programs and have made remarkable progress towards protection and management of forest, conservation planning, establishment and management of protected areas, biodiversity conservation, environmental management, coastal and marine resources, etc. Certainly, India is moving fast in the globally accepted direction so as to fulfill its local, regional, and national expectations, realizing countries' vision for sustainable development and to contribute meaningfully towards global commitments for two interrelated arenas, that is conservation and development. Thus, India has made a marked beginning. Nevertheless, country has to go still a very, very long way. The father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi, he had once said, "One must care about the world one will not see tomorrow." So we strongly believe in this wisdom of Mahatma Gandhi that trying to move in this direction where we aim for development without destruction and leaving the planet as beautiful for the coming generations. Just as our vision behind the Agenda 2030 is lofty, countries' development goals are nevertheless very comprehensive. It gives priority to the problems that have endured through the past decades. And it reflects our evolving understanding of the social, economic, and environmental linkages that define our lives. India welcomes the prominence given by various global initiatives to the environmental goals, especially sustainable management of forest, climate change, and sustainable consumption. Therefore, today, much of India's development agenda is mirrored in the sustainable development goals. Therefore, Government of India decided to abolish the well-known Planning Commission in 2015, instead established a new organization named as Niti Aayog, N-I-T-I, Aayog. The abbreviation N-I-T-I stands for the National Institute for Transforming India, while Aayog, which is a Hindi word, means a commission. So it is a new commission which has come into the force, focusing on transformation and primarily created organization to focus on the sustainable development in the country in accordance with UN 2030 agenda. While speaking on biodiversity conservation, India has made sustained efforts in fulfilling commitments towards conservation of biodiversity, its sustainable use, and the fair and equitable sharing of benefits arising from the use of biodiversity and natural resources. As a party to the CBD, India honors and strives to meet the international obligations and commitments under the convention. India's fifth national report, that is NR5, to the Convention on Biological Diversity, focused on the status of and trends in biodiversity, threats to biodiversity, and implication for human being. It described the process of updating the National Biodiversity Action Plan, that is NBAP, and its implementation and reports on progress achieved towards meeting the Aichi biodiversity targets and on the linkages with fulfillment of India's commitment to the Millennium Development Goals. In pursuance of the call made by UNFCCC in the COP, India's intended nationally determined contribution, that is INDC, is balanced and comprehensive. India seeks to reduce the emissions intensity of its GDP by 33 to 35% by 2030 from 2005 level. India is committed to create additional carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalent through additional forest and tree cover by 2030. In accordance with global agreements, the Government of India initiated Red Plus capacity building programs on the national level as well as at the state level also. Initially, forest officials are being trained for Red Plus implementation through various refresher courses by specialized organizations meant for this. It is amply clear that practicing foresters and forestry scientists are required to keep their knowledge also abreast, to know where forestry is heading and how the new field of research can contribute to better management of the forest. It is also equally important for the scientists working on these disciplines to know the way the forests are being managed with all socio-economic ramifications and ecological impacts. Moreover, there is a need for and constant dialogue and exchange of information among scientists and managers. As we all know, Forest Research Institute, that is FRI, has been there for the last more than 100 years and has always accepted new challenges in the field of forestry research, education, and extension. And during its long journey, right, since the time of its inception in 1906. Moreover, the network of multiple forestry institutions under the umbrella of Indian Council for Forest Research and Education and other sister research organizations in the field of wildlife conservation, forest management, environmental education, etc., working under Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change are also gearing themselves to contribute for the pressing needs of forestry and natural resource management, biodiversity conservation, climate change adaptation and mitigation, and sustainable development. Obviously, there are issues of declining productivity, challenges in maintaining viable populations, sustaining ecosystem services, and meeting people's needs at the same time. In recent years, the Forest Survey of India had started giving us valuable insight on forest quality besides vital information on forest extent in different states as well as the entire country. Forest institutions are making optimal use of remote sensing and GIS technologies to provide spatio-temporal information on land use and land cover, forests, and changes in the other natural resource like glaciers, snow, grasslands, wetlands, rivers, coastal and marine resources, and widespread agriculture. Innovative approaches are being adopted for community engagement, awareness management, and monitoring. However, we feel that there is an urgent need to support primary and field researchers for establishing a national forestry inventory system, focusing on the assessment on distribution, status, and availability of non-timber products, activity data on areas under different land categories. We have well-laid mechanism. Research, as I mentioned, research, we need to really sort of focus on various aspects of research. Along with research, training is another aspect where we have to really focus. We have well-laid mechanism and institutions for forestry and allied trainings at all levels, including regular training programs, short courses, specialized courses, refresher courses, and even mid-career training courses for the forest officers. However, our current efforts require augmentation and strengthening of such institutions, facilities, and program for training and upgrading of skills across wide-ranging sectors in view of the broadened scope of forestry. It is expected that the international mechanism will support such initiatives, including formation of thematic knowledge networks, further expand activities under Global Technology Watch Group, establishing more intensive state-centric knowledge and awareness creating activities and training of professionals in different aspects of forestry and climate change, and supporting research and development. In short, management of forest in future requires a holistic, integrated, cross-sectoral approach with a focus on people, planet, prosperity, and posterity to realize the vision of UN 2030 agenda. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Savida. Now we move to the next speaker on the panel, Dr. Suresh Garola. He is the Director General of the Indian Council of Forestry Research and Education. Dr. Garola, please.
Dr. Lakhani, distinguished panelists, learned delegates, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It's a matter of pleasure for me to be present here and discuss my views on the subject today from the perspective of my country, India. India recognizes that global commitments and concerted efforts are necessary towards global emissions reduction and reduction of vulnerability arising out of climate change. India is ready to offer its support to achieve consensus on this global issue. Such an agreement should address necessary elements, including adaptation, mitigation, finance, technology transfer, capacity building, and transparency in action and support. Thus, India is committed to engage actively in multilateral negotiations under UNFCCC in a positive, creative, and forward-looking manner. Our objective is to establish an effective, cooperative, and equitable global architecture based on climate justice and the principle of equity and common but differentiated responsibilities and respective capabilities under the UNFCCC. India is committed towards sustainable management of forest resources to combat climate change and for developing adaptation. Keeping in view its development agenda, particularly the eradication of poverty, coupled with its commitment to follow the low carbon path, to progress and being optimistic about the unencumbered availability of clean technology and financial resources from around the world, India has communicated its intended nationally determined contributions, INDC, in response to recent global decisions for the period 2021 to 2030. India's INDCs center around the country's policies and programs for sustainable lifestyles, cleaner economic development, reducing emission intensity of GDP, increasing the share of non-fossil fuel-based electricity, enhancing carbon sink, adaptation, mobilizing finance, technology, transfer, and capacity building. INDCs also capture citizens and private sectors' contributions in combating climate change. India's INDCs include One, reducing carbon intensity of its GDP by 33 to 35% from 2005 levels by 2030. Two, increasing the share of non-fossil fuel-based electricity to 40% by 2030. Three, accelerating afforestation efforts to create additional carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons of CO2 equivalent. Four, making concerted efforts toward adopting a climate change by enhancing investments in development programs in various vulnerable sectors, including agriculture, water resources, forestry, health, and disaster management. Fifth, capacity building. Sixth, resource mobilization. And seventh, adopt and promote low carbon intensive lifestyles. Government of India has established the National Adaptation Fund on Climate Change, that is NAFCCC, to fund these commitments. India has also agreed on a voluntary basis on a series of measures at the international and national levels to strengthen forest sector governance, technical and institutional capacity, policy and legal frameworks, forest sector investment, and stakeholder participation within the framework of national forest programs. Methodological guidelines for the implementation of REDD+ action are now finalized under UNFCCC, and India is preparing to implement REDD+ actions. Government of India has prepared a REDD+ reference document that gives broad guidelines for implementing REDD+ in India. Government of India is also in the process of developing a national strategy for REDD+ in India as a mandatory compliance to initiate REDD+. The National Working Plan Code 2014 integrates the requirements of REDD+ as committed by India, and it has now found a place in the management of the forests in the country. Government of India is also working towards integrating forest-related policies and programs into national development framework with an aim to reducing poverty and food security. India has comprehensive policy legislative framework for guiding forest conservation and management. In spite of severe pressures on forests and forest products, India has been able to nearly stabilize and maintain forests and tree cover in the last two decades. Under UN Convention on Desertification, after its ratification in 1996, India prepared its National Action Plan to combat desertification. India is also preparing its new National Action Plan to combat desertification, keeping in view the 10-year strategy of UNCCD to make India land degradation neutral by 2030. Till date, India has submitted 6 national reports to UNCCD Secretariat. The issue of desertification, land degradation, and drought are addressed by 22 major programs that are being implemented in the country under various ministries, including Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Rural Development, Ministry of Water Resources, Ministry of Panchayati Raj, and Department of Science and Technology. The 17 Sustainable Development Goals and 169 targets, part of 2030 agenda, find prominence in the policy framework being prepared by the Niti Aayog, that is Government of India think tank. Niti Aayog has undertaken a mapping of schemes as they relate to SDGs and their targets, and has identified lead and supporting ministries for each target. With this, I end my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gairol. Now, the next speaker on the panel is Mr. Ben Chikamai. He is the director of the Kenya Forest Research Institute in Nairobi, Kenya. Ben, please.
Yeah, thank you very much, Osni. As the focal person of CFA in Africa, I have examined the role of forestry in implementing international agreements at national level by reviewing information from about 10 countries in sub-Saharan Africa. I've gone to the extent of trying to look at the key international agreements where the member countries have had significant level of implementation. And I note that we are having actually four. We're having the UNFCCC, we're having the International Arrangement on Forests, UNFI, but we also are having the Convention on Biological Diversity, as well as the United Nations Convention on Combating Drought and Desertification. I have been able to try and look at the levels of implementation in the member countries, but also challenges which are affecting the implementation. And if we begin with the UNFCCC, I can say that most countries have actually ratified and have taken steps to incorporate the key issues and provisions from the convention into forest sector activities. And this includes the REDD+, which is actually a key approach for mitigating climate change, developing national climate change response programs, forest resource assessment methods, and inventories to take into account both the above and below ground carbon, as well as capacity development for managing carbon and other products and services. If I go by example, Kenya, for example, developed the National Climate Change Response Strategy in 2010, and to actualize the implementation, it put in place the Low Carbon Climate Resilience Development Strategy in 2012. It has been able to put in place the climate change policy and acts that became operational in 2016, the National Climate Adaptation Plan in 2016, and is currently working on the Green Growth Strategy and Climate Finance Policy, which are currently under development. I'd like to say that the country has also ratified the Paris Agreement on climate change and is currently updating the nationally determined contribution to the Paris Agreement with regard to mitigation and adaptation efforts. I looked at other countries and I found that Tanzania and Rwanda have also updated and revised their policies and acts to take into account the REDD+ as well as climate change related issues. And Botswana, Namibia, and Zimbabwe have also taken and included climate change in their long-term development plans. If you move to the international arrangements on forests, I would like to say that the UNFI is an instrument that is intended to strengthen political commitment and action for sustainable forest management of all types of forests and provide framework for national actions in member countries. However, unlike the others, this is an instrument that is little known beyond the focal points in the member countries. In fact, I found out that the only countries that have made some progress towards implementing the instrument are those that participated in the FAO pilot initiative projects of 2010-2013. And through that particular initiative, they were able to conduct awareness-raising workshops for the instrument and assessment of their forest programs in relationship to the instrument. The main gaps and priority areas were identified, and action plan for implementing and coordinating the activities were clearly developed. Of course, the new things that have come into effect are about six of them. And I would like to say that the main experience of implementing the forest instrument is that it provides a framework for comprehensive forest program that covers key elements for sustainable forest management. And an additional advantage is that it's both multi-sectoral as well as cross-sectoral, which has helped to raise the profile of forestry in the member countries. I would like to also add that most of the countries participated in drafting the first UN strategic plan for forests, 2017-2030, which was adopted in a special session of the UNFF in January. I think this provides the ownership that member countries are actually owning it and are moving in the right direction. And I know that when it will be ratified in May, it will actually be taken up by the member countries positively. Of course, when you look at the CBD and UNCCD, we have the main strategy as development of what we call the National Biodiversity Strategies and Action Plan, NPSAP, and we are having the National Action Plan for UNCCD. And most of the member countries have actually gone to the extent of not only trying to ratify and develop the plans, but some of the countries have even developed what you are calling the instruments, statutory instruments like joint forest management in Zambia and Zimbabwe, which has helped the countries to access quite a number of the funding, particularly the GEF. I would like to be able to just closely look at the challenges. And one of the major challenges that's facing most of the countries in implementing the international instruments relates to coordination. Especially for the CBD, you find out that the focal point is outside the main forest agency. And we know that coordination is stronger and more systematic where forest agencies are actually the lead ones. With regard to the forest instrument, which is supposed to be the main one, actually, there is no direct financial and technical support, unlike the other environmental multilateral agencies, which are having GCF and having Climate Adaptation Fund, as well as the GEF. Then, of course, lack of skills and requisite, actually, understaffing in member countries, which inhibits effective implementation in terms of monitoring and evaluation and ensuring that there is actually adequate coordination. We are having multi-sectoral approach, but most of these are on ad hoc basis, which again influences negative implementation of these particular instruments in the member countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ben, for summarizing the work in Africa on this. Now, the next speaker is Sir Harry Studholm. He's the chairman and of the Executive Office of the Forest Commission in England and Scotland. Sir Harry, please.
Good morning. It's wonderful to be here, and it's wonderful to be here as we've been reminded endlessly that this is a kind of almost a temple to forestry and its role. And I would first of all really like to thank Dr. Savita and Dr. Gairola for the chance to be talking about this, because these international agreements are a huge opportunity for forestry. And I have a bit of paper for, I asked my government what I was allowed to say, and so I have a bit of paper here which is absolutely true, which is we welcome the UN's Sustainable Goals, Red Plus, all of those issues, we welcome them. And they're great. They're a terrific opportunity for forestry. And as Dr. Hosni reminded us, I mean, the sums of money are staggering. I mean, absolutely staggering. I mean, the UK alone has said it would provide 5.8 billion between 2016 and 2021. I mean, that is many, many, many times the few millions that we spend on our own forestry and our own planting. That is huge. The other aspect that is absolutely immense from us foresters, and I think there are countries here where maybe they feel more empowered, that I feel quite a small cog in a very, very large government machine, but the existence of these agreements allows you to wave them at rather grumpy treasury officials who don't want to hear your voice. And I'm sure nobody else has that experience, that forestry is quite difficult to get into the minds of politicians. And so that is enormous. And we talked yesterday, I mean, Rob had produced a wonderful paper yesterday talking about communities and how you get things done. And actually, the world is fractal. You know, by the time you get to senior government figures, it's exactly the same as the village. You know, the problem of social capital, the problem of being able to talk to people, the problem of being able to get things done, the problem of sort of caste and where you sit in the network. And as a forester, you're quite unimportant in that. And so there is this opportunity But we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that there is a huge number of delusions here. Delusions in government, which produce these things which are top down. They don't, as Dr. Hosley said, they don't listen to what foresters say about how things should be done or what is possible. They don't listen to the fact that there is conflict when you try and change land use, that you have people on the ground who really do know what they're doing, who really care about their livelihoods and what they want to live their lives. And the top-down delusion is very, very strong. And we've got something to say in this, but we should also not be deluded. And as Rob Feely reminded us, that we don't communicate very well as foresters. We know what can be done. We know how to do it. We care about it. We really are concerned about trees and communities, but we're not very good at getting that influence in government to make things happen. And the real tragedy, and the tragedy of government over and over again, is that there is a curious paradox. There's a paradox about people's psychology, that ignorance leaves tremendous self-confidence. The organizations, the NGOs, speak with passion. They speak with passion because very largely they are ignorant of the difficulties of doing things. But that ignorance gets them influence. It gets them through doors because they're self-confident. They go through the door, they persuade the government, and then they do it. So there is a potential tragedy in all of these big international agreements that the people who will be implementing them will be the self-confident rather than the expert. And so in this, I would like to say, and the question is how we get from A to B, how we take these texts and make them work. The question, the one major answer to that is research. And standing here, I'm very aware of that. Research provides us with the credibility of being able to say things to government that government will listen to, because it's well scientifically based, and it speaks with a kind of authority that passion does not always speak with. It gives us the ability to fight ignorance. And ignorance in public debates, and we've seen so much of that in so many areas, and of course they're different in different countries, but there are issues around planted forests or issues around biomass and energy and great speeches which kind of ignore the complexity of all these issues. They are complex. And research allows us to empower extension services. Extension services allow us to get to people and make change. And so having a good research base is absolutely fundamental. And cooperation, international cooperation, is fundamental in that. So to carry on with the extension services, they must lie at the heart of all of this. The ability to reach out to people, the ability to talk to people and to listen. And listening is important. And I speak as a farmer and a forester, as well as doing my sort of part-time job for the government. And farmers and foresters are not fools. Some of them are, of course. There are fools everywhere. But a lot of people know what they're doing with their land. They care about their land. They want to take things into the future. They probably are as interested in sustainability or more interested than anybody because they have children and grandchildren. So if we are going to make change, we need to be able to talk to them, and we need to listen to their concerns, and we need to reach out to them. And underneath all of that, we need to understand what works for them, the commercial drivers, the economics of forestry. And I was really excited. There's a number of people I've talked to yesterday talking about the commercial drivers, the viability of agroforestry in Africa and some of the projects in India, making use of commercial drivers, showing people how they can make money, how they can have better livelihoods and a better future, and empowering people through that must be fundamental. So really, at the end of the day, I come back to, and in India, it's a wonderful thing to hear about the passion, the connection that people have with trees based on religious thought that dates back thousands of years. And we should build on that. We should build on connection and people to take what is the most enormous opportunity which could easily be lost. Thank you.
Harry, for these very passionate words. And now the final speaker on this panel is Dr. Peter Holmgren, who is the Director General of the Center for International Forestry Research in Bogor, Indonesia. Peter, you have the floor, please.
Thank you so much, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues. Great honor to stand here again, and now I made some scribbles. I hope I can read them. So, if this is indeed the Global Forestry Conclave, and this is the 16th chapel, and on the outside we have, on the Peter Place, a million people waiting for the white smoke or the black smoke about our decisions. If this is indeed the case, then I would be sure that the cardinals in the room would think about the same things that we're thinking. How do we stay credible? How do we keep our initiative in the light of the social media-driven beliefs out there? Would be the same kind of discussions. I don't think that this discussion is happening in many professional societies, if you like. So we get a lot of answers these days, and as we just hear, many of them are top-down. We're getting told what to do with our forests and our trees from many angles. They're often driven by completely different agendas, be it climate change, fear of biodiversity loss, rights issues, human rights issues, etc. But at the end of the day, I think we need to stop and ask ourselves, I think this is my phone making a noise. I think we should stop and really ask, what is the question that should produce that smoke and who is actually asking? If I get to ask the question, it would be something like, can we achieve a more equitable world where forests and landscapes enhance environment and prosperity for all? It happens to be the C4 vision. And I would send up a big puff of white smoke because I think we can. The question is, how do we go about it? We have all these international arrangements. Some of them relate to forests. And these have been fragmented ever since the Rio meeting in 1992. Lots of documentation about that. But at the end of the day, what significance do they actually have for the lives of people in communities on the ground? To what extent are they influencing national policies for real? We heard some connections from the panel. By real, I mean in the bigger picture, beyond the forest departments as such. Or are they more these days as a backdrop to actions that are taken more or less connected to those agreements actually signed? This notion of a backdrop is something we're picking up when we work on the Global Landscapes Forum going forward, that yes, we have an incredible backdrop of internationally agreed matters, ranging from human rights all the way over to the Paris Agreement and the SDGs. That's a backdrop for the actions we need to design and take. It's not what's telling us what to do. So from there, a comment on how are the perceptions of forests that drive these politics actually being shaped? Are they being shaped, I'm talking now about the broader communities and people at large, are they driven by the international arrangements on forests? No, I don't think so. Are they driven through research? Well, to some extent. But research has its own communication issues, and I wouldn't say really that's how it's driven. No, and as we just heard, I think it's driven very much by advocacy, more or less founded in research, more or less founded in real-world politics, but advocacy that tells us that plantations are bad, bioenergy is bad, certain ways of doing forestry is bad. And sometimes I refer to this as a monoculture of opinions. For example, in my country, in Sweden, there was a Gallup done and about what is the question of what is the most important role of forests? And 80% responded to store carbon. And I thought, that's funny. This is a forest country, a long tradition of forest management, community forestry, forest industry. And the answer today is that the forests are there to store carbon. How was that? How did that happen? Of course, advocacy reinforced by media, reinforced very much by social media, and of course, the international arrangements themselves are influenced by all this. So we have a kind of a circular politics here going on. One example I have of that is a speech that was held by a very, very senior UN official in the reopening of the Congo Basin Forest Fund the other year. And the speech was long and talked about all the benefits and good things about forests and how they contributed to the wealth of people and everything. And there was all those benefits except actually felling trees. It's also interesting. These things are being shaped and they're being circulated. So from there, how does CIFOR go about all this? And I mentioned that a little bit yesterday. I'd like to mention that, as it happens, I'm the first forester to head up CIFOR. Interesting fact too, but it's true. And the question we're facing is that we are a research organization. We've been doing forestry research through all of our existence, fairly broadly, ranging from livelihoods to environment to forest management. But still, it's research. And what we've come to is that research alone will not be very get a lot of traction. We need to combine that research with capacity development and with outreach and with engagement. I think we heard similar words from the panel. It's this mix that is necessary and possibly successful. I come back again to the Global Landscapes Forum. We are setting out in our next phase to engage 1 billion people. And in doing that, also redefining forestry to connect to the bigger picture of landscapes and the sustainable development goals. So finally, as an expert society, as we are as foresters or cardinals or whatever, what do we need to do? How do we need to behave vis-a-vis the rest of the world? And I think there are some parameters. The first one is to be credible. I think we can all agree on that. The next one is that we need to be relevant to the bigger picture. We can't just be relevant to ourselves. We have to be relevant to the bigger development picture, to the bigger political picture, and eventually, through a lot of hard work, influence those politics that shape the way we do forestry and the way people benefit from forests and trees. So relevance is important. Engaging, we can't sit in our chambers and think that we know best and that will happen eventually. And I would say, finally, we may need to be also a little bit provoking. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Peter. Well, ladies and gentlemen, you have it. Here is the, I think we heard from representatives from the six corners of the world, six continents, which is a very unique opportunity. We also from representatives of different disciplines, ranging from government agencies to education institutions and research institutions and education and research institutions. So I think we have the full spectrum of responding to the international agreements. I will not try to summarize some of these presentations because to me they are too rich to be summarized. But at the end, as we're asking everybody to give us one or two, maximum two messages to the conference. Now we will open the floor for discussion under very strict rules because we have to leave very early. And there will be some questions, but please, please just have a question. Because sometimes I know I'm one of the people who like to make a very good statement, a very long statement before I ask the question. I'm known for that. So we'll try to refrain from this. Just ask the question directly. And you can direct the question to one of the panelists or more, or just a general question. And we'll ask the panelists to be ready to answer. So can we start somewhere in the back this time? Because as Tony said yesterday, because the people sitting in the back, they don't get the chance. We have the young people, mostly students. I don't see. So we'll go to the first question. A question, please. Okay. There is one, two, three, four.
Thank you, Chair, sir. My name is A.K. Verma, and I'm from India. This is an appeal. This is an appeal to the panelists and to the working foresters. I'm a retired forester. please, could we have a relook at the strategy of buying off the conservation through RED, RED Plus, PES, or JFM by going through the impact of these projects worldwide? This is something which I always wanted to share with those who are in the position to do something on these issues. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Anybody from the panel volunteer to answer this? Sir Harry, please.
I hope I understood the question, but I think it goes back to what I said, is that the importance of listening to what is happening and then to communicate. And one of the problems that, as I was touching on, about foresters and experts and people, is that struggle, that very struggle to communicate lies at all levels, not just the people who are doing the RED Plus projects on the ground and the difficulties or not doing the RED Plus projects on the ground and what they may or may not be achieving. And it also speaks to the problem of getting politicians to hear. And their problem is that their rhetoric is what they are. You know, they need to do the rhetoric. It is sometimes uncomfortable for them to listen. But I think it is important for us to listen. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Harry. I think you know the politicians all too well. Very good. Second question here. Second question. Second and then the third. You're okay. The third, Andrew.
No problem. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't have any specific question directed to any panelists, but based on the presentations made by the panelists from six regions, I want to make a generic statement in one or two sentences. There is a need for strengthening partnerships between government, between private sector, corporations, NGOs, scientific and academic institutions. Because I come from India and I personally feel that here everything is by government alone, and certainly government must engage all stakeholders, number one. Then there is a requirement for strategic thinking in the forestry and biodiversity sectors, as it is relevant for any sector. And I must recommend that most of the professional foresters must also be management experts. Those who have not undergone management trainings, MBA courses, must undergo such courses so that they are able to think beyond forestry. Then third point I would like to highlight, that increasing use of social media in engaging with the stakeholders, that will help. Thank you.
Thank you very much for these suggestions. Third question, Andrew, please.
Thanks very much, Hosni. A panel, a question for the whole panel, I mean anyone who's willing. Drawing on the history of experiences with international conventions, and specifically the Vienna Convention on the Use of Lead in White Paint that was adopted in 1921, it took 76 years before the UN General Assembly, despite the scientific evidence being available throughout that 76-year period, before there was an agreement globally to remove the use of lead in petroleum products. So my question is to the panel, do they think that 2030 is a realistic time frame to achieve some of the goals which have been set up under some of the international agreements the panel talked about?
Thank you very much, Andrew. Would any member of the panel ventures to answer this question, that by 2030 we will have something done? Who wants to do it? Oh. Okay. Rob, please.
Thanks, Andrew. I think you can achieve anything if you really want to try. Part of when I was thinking about this panel, I've seen a number of these high-level discussions that operate sort of in a world that I just don't understand, which is the sort of NGO world, which is a lot different to where I'm operating with industrial forestry and actions and things on the ground. And I think you can implement change. Part of this is getting to the community, the points that Sir Harry was making about listening and communicating. They're really, really powerful tools once they happen, and politics and governments can move very quickly if they think they're not going to get elected. But they need that to get that picture that the community is unhappy with them over something in particular, but if it floats around, we have exactly the same problem in Australia with carbon and monitoring and in relation to, you know, greenhouse gas strategy is all over the place at the moment. Bioenergy is not right. We've managed to muddle up things that weren't overly difficult to do, and a lot of it's to do with our own political system. But I think, again, if politicians can see that there's a strength at a community level and at an actionable level, then you will see action quite quickly.
Thank you very much, Rob. We have a question here, and then, yes, next, and then the fellow. Okay.
Good morning. Let me introduce. I am Mohammed from Bangladesh. So actually, I don't have a question. I have comments, especially for the SDGs. All the countries have taken an initiative to implement the SDGs, but the ecosystem and the wildlife habitat, it doesn't have any the political boundary. So there are some challenges we have to face to implement these of the how we can overcome the challenges for the transboundary issues. So I think that point should be taken into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's a very important point, this transboundary issues, because forestry, as we all know by nature, it is transboundary. So the gentleman here, please. The mic here, please.
Thank you, sir. I have many, many observations and comments, but in deference to the chair, I'll ask just one single question. Sir, don't you think, and I ask the panel also, don't we think that taking into account such a large part of the forestry having come under the UN international processes, we should be able now to bring out a new synopsis of what is this part? Because in the agricultural university faculty of forests, it is taught in a different way. In the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, it would have a different flow, a different kind of a narrative. In our Dehradun-based institutions, the same subject would be taught a little different way, or not at all, probably. And also taking into account that the entire system from the legislative process in the UN, the New York, and right down to a forest block, it has to be explained in a certain way. So we bring it all together and put it in different kind of encapsulations, so that people are, the negotiators are a little more educated about the difficulties in the implementation and the other way. So this is one question, but of course, it's been such a rich panel discussion. I would like to ask more. But
yes, thank you very much. If I can rephrase the question as I understood it to the panel, can we educate the negotiators who are talking on our behalf, if this is the point? What's your opinion about this? Anybody volunteers an opinion about talking to the negotiators? John, please.
I think it is certainly possible to educate the negotiators. I have to say that as an educator. The question is whether the negotiators want to be educated. And we also heard about the NGOs who are very effective in negotiation. They don't feel they need to be educated either. So the challenge is ensuring that those who are negotiating on our behalf and on the behalf of the world actually understand the limitations in their understanding and the limitations in their knowledge.
Yes, thank you. As an example, in Jamaica, what we find is you really have to meet with and speak with and educate the persons who are in our Ministry of Foreign Affairs, because they're the ones who are really doing most of the negotiation. And what we have done is identified with the negotiator for different subject matters, and they tend to keep you informed. And so, like, preliminary meetings before sessions are usually held and discussions afterwards. And once you bring them, it's similarly to how we try and work with the Ministry of Finance to get some funding. We do that same thing with the people in foreign affairs. So if we tend to leave them out, they will go on their own agenda. But involve them, take them out to the forest, get them a feel for what we are doing, and you will find that they will be more amenable and keep you informed on decisions they're making.
Maybe Peter has an opinion about it.
Of course. I think it's rather unambitious to say that we should educate the negotiators. It's unambitious in two ways. It's unambitious because what we need to educate, if we use that word, is those that actually make the decisions in the first place. It's the parliamentarians, it's the politicians, it's the bigger picture people. It's not the negotiators. That's just the mechanics of the processes. They need to be educated as well. But that's the first way. The other way is that, of course, we need to educate everyone, not just the negotiators.
Thanks, Peter.
Good morning. I'm called Ojong Maxel Ayok, Minister of Forest and Wildlife, Cameroon. My question is addressed to Mrs. Savita and Mrs. Marilyn Headley. I was not very clear with the explanation on the process of the red strategy. I want to know the advancement, if they face any challenges. And finally, are they optimistic on the way the process is going on? Thank you.
Dr. Savita, please, and then Marilyn, please.
Thank you. In fact, I explained that there are many challenges before us, and majority of those challenges are concerning the burning issues before forestry, like climate change and conservation, biodiversity conservation and all. Since I am working in a research organization, my focus would be that we need to look into these challenges through research, education, and training people. We need to educate ourselves first, our scientists, our forest officers, as to how to deal with such issues. And there has to be a coordinated research which is to be taken up. We need to educate everybody of us first and then take this to the people at large, so that there is a clear understanding as to why we need to conserve and why we need to adopt certain measures which are going to go in for long-term conservation as such.
We're just starting our Red Plus program. So within our national plan, there are a whole set of actions that we look at step by step to go through the different phases to institute, get ourselves involved in the Red Plus program. So we're looking out to do analyze the drivers that drive deforestation and degradation. And we're also looking now to see how we can strengthen our forest monitoring system. And we're also looking at working closely with the climate change division to ensure that the NDCs involve the forest activity. The project we're looking at with the GCF, that we're proposing to GCF, is really to start this process in conjunction with an integrated landscape management program. So the Red Readiness and an integrated landscape program are pulling them together. And then we figure after we have all those steps in place, we can start looking at how we actually implement the Red Plus. And we know we're just at the beginning and a long road down the way.
Thank you very much, Marilyn. The lady there, please.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. After listening to Marilyn, Rob, Sir Harry, and John, one commonality to the international community of foresters can be drawn, that we need very strongly to build our capacity of forestry community on negotiations, conflict resolution, and general management ability, so as to really get our pathway lighted. And this is an appeal to the moderator that please include it in the recommendations of the panel. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the suggestion. Gentleman there, now behind you, that's yet your next role.
Sir, one single point. In democratic governance, politician is the most important instrument to change destiny. A lot depends upon the people who elect their leaders. Once we elect a leader who has a vision which is green, greener and cleaner society, I'm sure purpose for the forestry is served. I have seen in my own estate, when we have a leader who has a vision for forestry, budgetary allocation for the forestry within 2 years has increased by more than 200%. Therefore, if we have to educate somebody, we have to educate the society. Once people are educated in democratic governance, once they elect a leader, I think rest is automatically taken care of, because these politicians, they represent the country, they are the negotiators. If they are educated, welfare for the forestry is taken care of. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. If I may just take the liberty to comment on this. Indeed, we always elect leaders with vision, and I have never seen any leader without a vision. So this is, it depends what vision it is, and recently we have heard some very special visions for the future. So next question, please.
Hello. Thanks, Hello. Hosni, Tim Ryan, Canada. I really like the comments on credibility and relevance of foresters. The part that's missing for me, though, is the credibility and relevance of a forester versus a professional forester. We will not have credibility or relevance if we don't have some standard of performance to govern and to direct our credibility and relevance. I'd like to hear the panel's thoughts on professional forestry.
I think professionalism is very, very important. I think the ability that when you train as a professional, you learn a far wider range of things than you learn through, say, for instance, learning on the job. You have an organization that defines what is a good code of practice and how you should operate, and it provides a way for people to be respected and actually create influence at community level, not just necessarily at a higher level. So I believe passionately in professionalism, and I would go on further and just mention standards. Because one experience of the UK is that the certification processes do not get the bite that they should do. I mean, there are some that are better than others, but that FSC has had huge problems because it does not engage with the small landowner, the small forester trying to make a living. It's very, very difficult to fill out the forms and to deal with all the issues and to pay the costs of it. So standards have provided a backdrop to have a UK-based forestry standard, which provides a document which tells everybody how they should manage their forests, is very powerful. So I believe in professionalism, I believe in professional standards, and I believe in standards. And I think that was a totally proper comment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sir Harry. Dr. Savita has a comment, and maybe John.
I would also like to comment on this.
Please.
I'm a practicing forester for the last 32 years, and what I feel is that the credibility of a forester is not going to come through only through preaching. You just go to the communities and start talking about various things, that you do this and you do that, and then that is how we are going to go in for resource conservation as such. What I feel is that we need to show them that we are committed, the foresters are committed, and that commitment has to run, has to be manifested in our action plan. So we need to really convince communities and all those stakeholders whom day and night we keep telling that we are not required to do this or we are required to do that. We need to really show through our action, through our activities, through our total planning, that our commitment is 100% for the resource conservation. And this kind of commitment we are asking from them also. We need to really work with them all through. We need to associate with them. And I mean, every action of ours has to really convey that we are as committed as the kind of commitment we are looking for.
Thank you. John, you wanted to?
Thank you. As a professional forester, I completely agree with what you just said. In fact, it is my goal to try and establish a system of professional foresters throughout the Commonwealth. And I know there are several people here, including one of the panelists here, who shares that goal. We would like to see all foresters in the Commonwealth as professional foresters, answerable to standards, and with required education levels and required levels of competence, required levels of standards, required levels of ethics.
Thanks, John. The lady in the back, then Tony, sorry. Please stand up, who wants to ask a question so that we can see you. Please go ahead. Excuse me, sir. The lady in the back, she's going to ask first.
As world has become a global village, these days I want to know that how do we teach the little children, because children are our future. So how do we teach the 3 R, recollecting the third R. How do we teach the little children that the conservation is very important? So my question is there any effective program to teach them globally or in individual countries?
Thank you. Any volunteer to answer the question about teaching the new generation? Peter, please.
Thank you, and that broadens the question of education quite a lot, and I think it's really, really important. As we talk about, you said you called it reduce, recycle, and the picture that we need to provide, not just for the children but for everyone, is that the forests and the trees are part of a circular economy where we should use the material and then regrow it and manage it well. And today, the general picture that's out there is that forests are there to be protected only. So there is a huge educational learning aspect to this. One of the four components of the future of the Global Landscapes Forum is exactly about this. It's about learning, and it's not just about learning at an academic level, it's learning much more generally. Thank you.
Thanks, Peter.
About this issue of 3 R's, of course, very, very important, because children are our future. So far as India is concerned, already a lot of initiatives have been taken. For example, establishment of green clubs at the level of various schools has really sensitized not only the school children but also the parents and the teachers about the need to conserve our resources. We have to have better reach to the students in terms of sensitizing them for various conservation needs. Recently, Government of India has launched a Science Express, if you are aware, to sensitize people and children in particular about the need to conserve our resources to ensure that we live in a better world tomorrow. So there are various ways and means, and I'm sure various countries are already at it. Thank you.
Much. Now, Tony Bartlett. Sorry, Tony, I didn't see you. You're hiding there. Please go ahead.
Unusual for me to hide, Hosni. A question for John Innes. Why do you think the mechanism, the Standing Committee on Forestry, has lost interest amongst the leaders of forestry in the Commonwealth countries? And is there anything that could be done to revitalise that mechanism or some alternative mechanism to try to help address issues like the one you spoke about, declining interest in forestry education, which may not be a sexy, popular, passionate type issue, but those foresters understand that if there are no future foresters, then all of these global agreements on doing this and doing that are really going to be hard to implement. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on that.
Thanks, Tony. Direct Australian question, please.
I th- It's a very difficult question to actually answer. I think there has been, when we meet at things like the Council of Forestry in Rome, organized by the FAO, we have been having side meetings of the Standing Committee on Commonwealth Forestry. And one of the problems is that there's a lack of communication within individual forestry agencies and between those agencies and those who are representing the agencies at FAO, at the COFO meetings. So the Standing Committee on Commonwealth Forestry members are actually the heads of the forest services of each of the Commonwealth countries. Well, Australia, just to give an example, I mean, who is that? And we've had some difficulty identifying the individual. We often have representation from Australia, but then they say, well, we're not actually the right people to be dealing with this. When we look elsewhere, it's a very similar situation. And who is the right person in the United Kingdom, for example, today? Who is the right person in Canada? Actually, we know that one quite well, because there is still a Canadian Forest Service, and there is a Director General of it. Many other countries either don't send anyone to the COFO meetings, or they have very little forestry within the Commonwealth. I think we're getting some of the key players, but we're not getting as many as we would like to create the momentum that we could have at, for example, the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting. And that's really where I think we need to get some momentum going. We need to have a voice that we can tell the politicians at that Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting that forestry would like to see a particular thing happening. And getting that message over is very, very difficult because of the political processes involved.
The gentleman, excuse me, the gentleman first, and then you, sir. Okay, go ahead, please. Quick question, because we have only 2 minutes before we finish. Thank you.
Sir, with the discussion which has held today, okay, it is very clear that the policy formulation has actually been taken over by the international agencies. The individual countries need not bother about policy, broad policy framework on forestry issues. What they need is only to fine-tune it and frame strategies and emphasize on its implementation.
Okay, so please go to the question because, as I said, we have only 2 minutes.
My point is the SDGs has actually, sir, the SDG mainly focuses on conservation, improving the forest cover and improving the growing stock. All these primarily need the plantation. The plantation is the at the core of all these activities. And what we need is sound nursery techniques for raising quality plantations. As of now, we don't have any institutional mechanism first to generate the time series data on survival percentages of the plantations and then to monitor it. And also, we need to assess the plantation potential at the lowest administrative level for the successful implementation of all the policies. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for the comments. The gentleman there, please. Quick question, please.
I was interested to
hear you, sir. Mic, please. It's not working.
Hello. I was really interested to listen to some bold policies from the bold people sitting there on the panel. We have problems at the ground level, at the grassroots level, which nobody has touched. You're talking about research. Where are the sample plots? You're talking about the quality of foresters. Where are the compartmentary files written by them? What's the role of the corporations, forest corporations in this country? unemployment is so much in the villages, in the areas. These things are more important. People have talked all about the data which the politicians talk about in their conferences. I personally feel only now Madam Swetha has talked about the quality of foresters. They should be committed. They are already committed. But there should be now plan, but there should be a scene between all of us that we have to be committed and we have to go to the forest areas. We have to do surveys. We have to do inspections. And then we have to sample plots also, maintain them properly. And the corporations must work for the people, for the unemployed people. And the corporations should work as technical corporations, not foresters. They are a different role. And in education, we have not talked, nobody's talked that we should introduce the control or the safety of animals in the wildlife or the about wildlife. Education is an important issue in which we have also to participate. And we have to go to the governments and talk to them that these introduction of these policies is also important so far as safety of the animals is also concerned. Unemployment, population increase, nobody has talked. Very sad.
Thank you, sir. I think the panel shares your views on this. This would be the last comment. I'm sorry to cut the discussion short because that is we are committed to lead, to finish at 10:45. So with this, is it a very burning question or?
Yeah.
Because we have to, okay, please go ahead.
I'll take half a minute.
Okay.
We talk about so many agreements and everything is all ultimately about investment. But in this hall, I don't see many bankers. That is the only thing I wanted to tell.
I take your point very seriously. The bankers are waiting for us outside. So. Have you ever heard of a banker attending a conclave?
Yeah, I'm also a banker, but thing is, if you are taking me as a representative of banker, that's okay. But thing is, if they are not coming to us, then we have to go to them.
Thank you. The money's. So with this, I would like to join me thanking the panel. It's been a very lively discussion. We could just spend 2 or 3 days in the same conclave and discussing these issues. But please join me in thanking the panel. And thank you, audience, for a very active participation. Thank you. Thank you very much.